This tutorial will show you how to create and run automated load tests with LoadComplete. LoadComplete is used to create and run automated load tests for web servers and services. It includes a number of powerful features that enable you to check your web server's performance under massive load, determine its robustness, and estimate its scalability. Creating load tests with LoadComplete is very simple. You use LoadComplete to record your actions on the tested web server and then replay those actions using multiple virtual users. Let me show you how to do this. Before creating a load test using multiple virtual users, we need to record user actions to be simulated against the tested web server. LoadComplete records these actions in the form of user scenarios. To record a scenario, I click Record a New User Scenario here on LoadComplete's start page. This will invoke the Create New Project wizard. This wizard assists you in creating a test project that will store your load tests. LoadComplete is asking me to create a new project right now because there's no open project. So on the first page of the wizard, we can specify the name and location of the project. We'll click Next. On this page, we can select the servers whose performance LoadComplete's going to monitor. I'm going to be doing all my tests locally right now, so I'm going to specify localhost. And then click Next. On the final page of the wizard, you can specify settings that allow you to control the performance of the tested application. Using these settings, you can specify a threshold time value for request transferring and page loading processes. If a real-time value exceeds the specified values here, LoadComplete will report an error message. So I'm going to put in the desired values here. I'm going to keep the page load threshold at 5 seconds, and I'll put the maximum response time at 10 seconds. And now I'll click Finish. So now LoadComplete has created a new project, and it's brought up this Record User Scenario dialog. This dialog allows you to specify the name of the scenario that will be recorded, right here, and you can specify the name of the test that will be automatically created on the basis of this recorded scenario. Here you can also specify whether LoadComplete will automatically launch a browser when you start recording your scenarios. And right here you can put in the URL to the website that you want to test. In my case, it's just going to be localhost slash LoadComplete. Alright, so now we click the record button. And now LoadComplete goes into recording mode. It displays this recording toolbar up at the top of the screen, and that indicates we are currently recording. Once the recording has been started, LoadComplete automatically launches the desired web page in the browser that we selected, and now we can perform some actions that we expect our users will be doing on this website. So I'm going to log into my server here as tester password of test. We'll click login, and we'll perform some actions here. I'm going to edit this user's order, and let's make some changes to his order. We'll say he wanted the My Money product, and then we'll update that order. So LoadComplete is recording all the requests that the browser is sending to the server, and it's also recording the server's responses to those requests. So now I'm going to log out of my website, and then I'll stop recording just by clicking the stop button here. And now LoadComplete's going to save the recorded traffic in the form of an HTTP scenario, and it will display it in the scenario editor right here. This editor allows you to view and modify the recorded scenario. On this portion of the editor panel, you see a list of the recorded requests. I'm just going to expand all these right here. And when you select a given request in the list, you can explore its contents and parameters using the Request tab of the scenario editor. On the response page, you can view and correct the properties and contents of the response received from the tested web server for that request. And then finally, this general page lets you specify custom response codes, or you could mark the request as a synchronization point. But in our scenario today, we're not going to do any of that stuff. We're not going to modify our scenario in any way. The next thing I'm going to do is check whether the recorded scenario works properly. And to do that, I'm just going to right-click the scenario here in the editor, and I'm going to select Verify Scenario. Now LoadComplete's going to play back the recorded scenario for a single virtual user. It's executing the recorded requests and comparing the actual responses that we're getting back from the server to the ones that were recorded. And if the actual response coincides with the recorded values, then the test engine considers that scenario works as expected. Note that LoadComplete neither launches the browser nor does it simulate user actions against a browser. It just plays back the recorded HTTP requests and checks the server responses. And because of that, these operations don't require user intervention. Now, during the scenario run, LoadComplete retrieves various performance parameters from the tested server and displays them on that runtime graphs page, which we can get back to just by double-clicking on this load testing item right here. We'll talk about these items a bit later. So at the end of the scenario verification, this summary panel here shows the overall status, and we can see that this scenario has run successfully. And this means that the actual responses match the recorded responses, and the specified quality of service criteria haven't been violated. So we've ensured that the scenario works fine for one virtual user, so now we can play it back with more virtual users. To simulate multiple virtual users, we need to have a load test, and we can create a load test using LoadComplete's dialogs or by using the default load test. And this default load test right here, which you can get to by double-clicking on this node in the tree, is automatically created by LoadComplete when you record a scenario. The scenario editor here in the center of the screen allows us to define the virtual users that will execute a given user scenario during the test, and it allows us to set some properties for those tests. As you can see, the default test only contains one virtual user for running the particular scenario, but we can add more users, easy enough, just by clicking inside this user count column, and then we can just type in the number of users we want to run. So in this case, we'll run 10. We can also give a unique name to those virtual users. We could call them VUser, and that will help us track those users inside the test results. Now, using the load test editor, you can also specify what computer the users will be simulated from. In this case right here, coming from my local system, which is called Master. You can also choose which browser will be emulated. You can also toggle the connection speed, and you can tweak the start delay. If you'd like, you can add additional groups of virtual users to the test. Now, one thing to note here is that your total number of virtual users can't exceed the limit allowed by your license. But to add another group of virtual users, you could right-click here and say New Item, and then we could say VUser Group 2. And then these virtual users could be running a separate scenario. For example, they could run scenario 2 coming from a different workstation. And then in the results, you'd see virtual users coming from the VUser group and from VUser group 2. Now, below the virtual users, there are several tab pages where you can choose the type and dynamics of the workload to be specified. The load profile page allows you to select the mode in which the test will simulate the virtual users. If you use this steady load option, then the load test will start all the virtual users concurrently. The stepwise option enables the test to emulate a smooth load increase on the server. And then the custom shape option allows you to visually specify the desired workflow. So what you do here is you double click on this graph and you actually draw the pattern that you want your virtual users to follow during the course of the test. Now for our test, we're going to use the stepwise profile. And what I'm going to do is start out by working with one virtual user and then add one more virtual user every 5 seconds. Now this continuous load page includes the option that enables you to execute the load test repeatedly during the specified time period. So suppose we need to simulate a massive load for 5 minutes. In this case, what we'll do is we'll check this enable box and set the test duration to 5 minutes. This way, if our load test finishes before that specified time elapses, then the test will be run again. On this random think time page, you can tell the test engine to randomize the think time between the simulated requests. To do this, you just need to enable it, and then specify the range of possible time values here in these fields. In our test today, we're going to use the recorded think time, so I'm not going to enable this option. The final tab here is the quality of service editor, and this page allows you to specify settings for verifying the time spent on traffic simulation. And these settings are applied to the current load test only. We're going to leave these disabled. So in this case, the test engine will use the quality of service settings that we specified during project creation. The last thing I'm going to do before running the test is specify which server metrics LoadComplete should track during the test execution. So I'm going to switch to the runtime graphs by double-clicking on the load testing tab right here. And currently, this page displays a graph for the load test simulation parameters that were monitored during the scenario's verification. And LoadComplete will also monitor these metrics during test execution. Now, LoadComplete supports a lot of counters that allow you to measure various performance characteristics, time metrics, request and response speeds, server-side metrics, and so on. And you can monitor these characteristics on one graph, like what I'm doing right now, or across several graphs by clicking on the Panes button right here and choosing Four Panes. For each graph, you can choose from predefined sets of counters to be monitored, or you can create a custom list down here. For example, let's say I only want to review the transfer time and response speed. Well, those counters are available, and I can just check those two boxes here and here. Besides the predefined counters, LoadComplete can monitor various other counters provided by the tested web servers. You can add these counters to the runtime graphs using the counters dialog. So you can just right-click inside here, select counters, and then you could add any one of the counters that you'd want. I'm not going to do that for right now, so I'm just going to cancel out of here. So now let's run our tests, and to do that, I'm just going to click this run button right here. LoadComplete is going to play back the user scenario for multiple virtual users, and we can watch how LoadComplete plots the measured characteristics here on these graphs at runtime. Now notice that the playback is going without user intervention, so we recommend that you close all your browsers before you run your load tests so that you don't accidentally introduce noise into your load test results. After the test is over, LoadComplete generates detailed reports of the results and displays them on several panels. Let's start analyzing results from the report panel that you see right here. This panel consists of several pages that provide basic information about a given test run and illustrates the test run statistics. For example, here on the Summary tab, we have brief information on the test run itself. Down in the General Informations area, we have the test's start time, its total duration, and the result of the test run. And here we see that the test ran with warnings and errors. To view these errors, I can just press this View button right here. LoadComplete then switches over and displays the messages panel of the test log. This panel contains messages that were sent to the log during the run, and here you can see messages informing you that a request was completed and warning messages informing you that LoadComplete was unable to simulate some connections and requests for one reason or another. For example, this error message tells you that the quality of service criteria was violated. And this can be caused by several different factors. The first is that your server's performance isn't fast enough. And so to find the cause of the server's poor performance, you can speak with your server's administrator. Another possible reason is that the quality of service criteria are too strict. In this case, you could try to increase the page load time threshold on the general settings page of the load testing editor. You can also just disable these options in order for LoadComplete to not verify the time spent on traffic simulation. Besides error messages, you can also see warnings. For example, this message right here is telling you that a request was completed with a warning. And when you choose a message like this, the request headers and response panels that you see here display the contents of the request that was sent to the server and the response that came back. These panels help you compare the request and response data and determine the cause of the warning. You can find more information on resolving warnings and errors by viewing another video up on our website. So now let's switch back to the report panel. The summary section here also tells you information about the traffic simulation and information about the number of simulated requests and posted messages. You can see those here under the page load time, time to first byte, and time to last byte sections. And this page also includes a section that provides high-level information on the number of simulated virtual users down here in this load profile graph, and it also contains detailed statistics on the requests sent to each server that was accessed during the run. You can see that down here in the Servers tab. The Pass-Fail page contains summary information on the requests simulated during the test run. It also provides charts that represent the results of loading pages and page resources. The response time page contains graphs that represent the changes of the main test run metrics in time. The infrastructure page contains graphs that represent the changes of the request speed and the response speed metrics in time. This final page, top 10, contains a list of the slowest pages, so you can easily see what page and what request took the most time to load. This concludes our tutorial. You've seen how to create a project in LoadComplete, record, modify, and replay a simple load test, and how to analyze test results. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to contact us at smartbear.com. We wish you luck and hope you enjoy testing your web applications with LoadComplete.